For many years, I have been wanting to make a film on Charles Correa's architecture. Every time I saw a Correa building, I was intrigued by its appearance and wanted to know more. Hence, this film, which is not just a catalogue of Correa's large body of work, but a personal investigation into the mind of a very important contemporary artist. It all started 20 years ago, while shooting a Correa building for another film that I was making at that time. I began to observe it carefully by moving through and around the building. I felt the rhythms of its spaces, noted how it responded to changing light. It was a deeply moving experience. It led me to study his other buildings and, finally, to this film.
I think I became an architect because of toy trains. As a child, I had some old tin plate rails and a couple of locomotives and wagons. Nothing more ambitious. Really just enough to run the trains around your room and the following day perhaps change the layout so that they could run into the next room, under a table and back again. That was the marvelous thing about those old tin plate trains. They had flexibility. I drew out on graph paper the most elaborate layouts, straight rails, curved ones, sidings, crossovers, the works. Trains moved through tunnels, stations, over bridges in one direction, and then through cunningly placed figure eights came right back through the same stations and tunnels. But now in the other direction, setting up a brand new sequence. Anyway, that's how I spend many of my classroom hours drawing out those hypothetical layouts in my exercise book. Years later, coming for the first time across an architectural journal, I felt I could read the various plans and sections and what they were trying to do. That much I owed to toy trains.
Correa started his practice in 1958, here in Mumbai. His architecture is very much a hands-on activity, a cottage industry, as he says, like handicrafts or carpet weaving. I remember the first Correa building I ever saw, the Gandhi Smarak Sangrahalaya at the Sabarmati Ashram in Ahmedabad, a memorial to Mahatma Gandhi, a museum of his letters, photographs and books, and a center for studying Gandhiji's life and values.
We had to make a place which spoke of Gandhiji and his life and his values and his philosophy. It's amazing what he achieved. And very simply, look at his last possessions. Just some simple objects. I think two pairs of chappals and a lota, and then some glasses, I think, spectacles. And I think there was three monkeys, which always like, see no evil, speak no evil, hear no evil. So It's actually, here's a man who's, I think, a wonderful man. I'm glad he's back in fashion. But really, I don't think he had an aesthetic sense, a visual sense, any more than Mao Zedong, who also changed his country. But this picture is probably the most aesthetic picture I know of from that period. This is almost like Zen philosophy. Now, how do we express that in a building? That is what architecture is about.
There was an elegance, an austere beauty about this architecture, and a masterful use of light and shade.
The soil there is very bad. It's reclaimed soil on the edge of the river, the Sabarmati River. And so we had to put in these columns which were on a foundation. And in between we had to span with a beam, plinth beam it's called. And so the idea came up, instead of keeping that plinth beam at ground level where it's really usually kept, I thought if we kept it slightly above the ground, then it seems to make the building float, which it is. You suddenly see that in the Katsura Palace in Japan, that the slightly floating effect gives a sense that it's hovering there, and that lightens everything, yes.
The remarkable thing about this building is its very human scale. Each unit is only 6 meters by 6 meters, on a grid of columns just over 2 meters high. On these are placed U-shaped beams, which also act as channels to drain out the rainwater. Over this are the pyramidal roofs of wood and clay tiles. Since the books, letters, and other exhibits would grow over the years, Correa made its structure modular for easy expansion. The structure is a matrix of covered and open spaces, which creates a feeling of lightness and transparency.
I think I got this idea from one of my professors at MIT, Juri Kepish. He used to say that museums are very tiring experiences and only tourists have the energy to go through them, like in the Louvre, where you have to go from room to room to room looking at things. And he said, museums must have spaces where the eye can rest. Maybe it's a little courtyard or a garden. I've always remembered that, and the museums I've designed, they've never been one continuously enclosed space.
An essential element in Correa's architecture is the pathway. We will meet this pathway in Correa's work in many different ways throughout this film. In this particular building, it gives you the feeling of walking through an Indian village, like the villages that Gandhiji always loved. When he inaugurated the building in 1963, Prime Minister Nehru said, "You have built here a beautiful museum. Whatever I have seen has been done with understanding of a sort that suits this holy place. There is nothing pretentious here. It is a simple and lovely building." And Kenneth Frampton, the noted architectural critic, has written, "The Gandhi Museum remains one of the most compelling national monuments erected anywhere in this century." Correa has received national as well as international recognition and the very highest awards of his profession. In 1984, he was presented with the gold medal of the Royal Institute of British Architects by Prince Charles at Hampton Court Palace. In 1991, the gold medal of the International Union of Architects. In 1993, the Premium Imperiale from Prince Hitachi of Japan.
The Premium Imperiale.
International advisor David Rockefeller Jr. remarked that it required more than 20 years for the Nobel Prize to receive worldwide recognition, but in just 6 years, many people had already come to understand the importance and prestige of the Premium Imperiale.
Before the Nobels gained world attention.
All the winners are artists of unique accomplishment.
The president then introduced each of the recipients and his works. Each was greeted with warmth and congratulations.
In 1998, the Aga Khan Award for Architecture from King Carlos of Spain, and in 2006 came the Padma Vibhushan from the President of India.
Padma Vibhushan, Shri Charles Correa,
Correa was born in Secunderabad in September 1930. The family moved to Mumbai to stay with his grandparents because of the early death of Charles's father. They lived in Ballard Estate near the docks, and the children were often taken to see the ships.
We would go there as children and you could see the sea. There were no, and the ships would come at Ballard Pier, and now and again we could get to see them. We were taken on a Saturday morning, let's say. It was beautiful to go and see those ships. I just liked them very much, especially the ones in dry dock. There's something really incredible about, and we weren't allowed down, but you'd see the divers would go down first and place the blocks, and the ship comes in. Then they pump out the water, and there's this incredible thing.
You know, this hull is designed to keep out the most violent seas. As someone once said, real beauty has terror in it.
It was very easy for me to understand what drove people like Corbusier and Gropius and the whole aesthetic of the modern movement, because their ideas were based on the beauty of ships, steam locomotives, big bridges, grain silos, all the things which engineering had produced in the 19th century. And which we actually see around us.
In 1948, when Charles was 18 years old, he left for the United States to study architecture. He got his bachelor's degree from the University of Michigan in 1953, and in 1955, his master's degree from MIT. Where he was lucky to have great teachers whose ideas influenced him.
I had teachers like Bucky Fuller, who was a wonderful man. He was an architect in a very special sense. He was really also an inventor. You know, he's the one who did these geodesic domes. And his output was incredibly varied. It was automobiles and houses and metaphysics and structural geometry. But what was constant through it all was his vision and his principles. And there was Kepish, a painter who had come across from the Bauhaus. Kepish ran a seminar which taught me how to think and how to articulate ideas. He didn't teach architecture. He spoke about painting, about music, about literature, about other things.
Of course, what I'd learned in America are the principles that make architecture. The principles that you look for local materials, you deal with the climate, you try to deal with the culture, the aspirations of the people there. That's what architecture is about.
Correa's thesis at MIT was truly original. It wasn't the design of a building. Instead, he made a film, an animation film. Films and filmmaking have always fascinated Charles. In fact, he sees clear creative links between architecture and filmmaking. Architecture is also a succession of images, he says. The main difference is time. After finishing his master's degree, Correa returned to India in 1955.
We made a tryst with destiny.
It was a newly independent India, going through an exciting period in all fields, including, of course, architecture.
And of course, there was Corbusier building in Chandigarh, so India was a very rich place to come back to.
When I got back, I went to places like Delhi or Calcutta. And it was wonderful to go up there and see the Mughal architecture, see the wonderful architecture produced.
You know, if you look at what the Mughals built up in Delhi in that area, it's really brilliant. They made these courtyards, and in the early morning, they would stretch a shamiana across them so they could trap the cold night air. In the evening, when the temperature had cooled down, they would come out on the terraces. And then if you look at the indigenous architecture in the villages and in the towns, it's really wonderfully inventive, both in form as well as in color.
In Sindh, for instance, or in Iran, they have wind catcher houses. These are houses which have a scoop to catch the desert wind, and it goes down into the basement where it passes over a pool of water and becomes humidified, and then it comes up to the rooms. I think Corbusier called a house a machine for living. But these things are, I don't think he ever produced something as dramatic as this. So that influenced me a lot, and some of my early work was all about really dealing with the climate. That means by triggering off something in your imagination about form.
In 1961, the Tube House won first prize in an all-India competition for low-cost housing. Here, a current of natural ventilation is generated by the very shape of the unit. Hot air rises and escapes from the top, drawing in fresh new air to replace it. The Parikh House consists of two different sections. The summer section, to be used in the hot afternoons. Next to it, the winter section, where the terraces open up to the sky. His Ramkrishna House, designed for one of the wealthiest mill owners of Ahmedabad, uses the same principle as the Tube House. The plan sets up a series of parallel brick walls, punctuated by interior courts, climaxing in the living room which opens onto the main garden. A seminal project in the development of these ideas was the Hindustan Lever Pavilion, an experimental design built for the 1961 industrial fair in Delhi. Once again, we find the pathway taking us through the building. The random structure had no right angles. Its fractured surfaces produced startling spaces, scaleless and disorienting. Today, such architecture is considered very avant-garde, but the Hindustan Lever Pavilion was built more than 40 years ago. Though Charles has always worked from Mumbai, this city has only a few of his buildings. One of them is Kanchenjunga. I vividly remember how this building sort of jumped at you every time you came over the rising curve of Pedder Road, with its stark minimalism and brilliant colors. Although Kanchenjunga was built more than 30 years ago, it still stands out as a unique edifice in the city. When I learned that the traditional bungalow was the inspiration for this high-rise building, I was really intrigued.
The principle of the traditional bungalow is extremely simple and effective. The main living spaces are surrounded by a ring of verandas which provide an extra layer of protection against the sun and the rain. The idea is to make this veranda into a double-height terrace garden where we can use the rain and the sun to help the plants to grow. Such a unit can then interlock with the one below. Here are the two units drawn to scale and repeated with variations to create a tower 29 stories high of luxury apartments, varying from 2 to 6 bedrooms.
Rising to a height of 80 meters, Kanchenjunga is an elegant piece of sculpture. From the upper bedrooms, the double-height terrace gives one a diagonal view across Bombay, with the overhanging cantilevered slab above acting like a great protective eyebrow. Kanchenjunga stands like a tree of life, the rest of Bombay all around. But there are other Bombays as well. Today, more than 10 million people live in slums. This is Dharavi, one of the largest slums in the whole of Asia, with more than 600,000 inhabitants.
One is struck by the astonishing ability of people to try to humanize the wretched conditions in which they are condemned to live. Somehow, even in these crevices, life continues. But beyond this, Dharavi is a vivid illustration of the grotesque mismatch in our cities between demand and supply. A mismatch where only the rich can survive. In Bombay today, 10 million people are living in this kind of degrading squalor.
In 1940, the population of Bombay was just 2 million. By 1964, it had grown to 4.5 million. And the first squatters had started to appear. By 1984, the population was 8 million, of which 4 million were squatters. Today, it is over 16 million, of which almost 10 million are squatters. Back in 1964, when illegal settlements had just started to appear, Correa and his two colleagues, Shirish Patel and Praveena Mehta, argued passionately for opening up the mainland across the harbour, before the city was engulfed by a sea of squatter colonies. In order to convince the government and to encourage public discussion of these vital issues, Correa made this film called The City on the Water, explaining to citizens what was happening to their city and to their lives.
Incredible, isn't it? 500,000 people arriving every morning. Nobody leaving.
Morning arrives, and with it starts the collection of water for the day's needs, the elementary essentials of life.
From further and further north, the people come. About 2 or 3 persons a day are killed, falling off these trains. People need transport to find jobs. So they live illegally around the station. Do we really have to treat people this way?
The facts of the matter are brutally simple. You've got to be rich to afford Bombay. The city is really one long breakwater, protecting the harbour from the open sea. Opening up the harbour will bring the waterfront back to Bombay. Plazas, like the Gateway, along the eastern shore of the island, will change the north-south structure into an east-west one. And looking eastward, the energy of New Bombay will stimulate development in the mainland, opening up new growth across the state. Water will once again become the focal point of the whole system, providing communication between the various centers. And in the middle of it all, the island of Elephanta. An umbilical cord that takes one back 1,000 years. Bombay from now on will become a multi-centered city around the harbour, each new centre opening up more space for the people of this city.
In 1970, the government accepted the idea and created CIDCO to design and develop the new city. Today, Navi Mumbai's population is nearing 2 million, but unfortunately, the crucial benefits of using public transport and of orienting this new growth towards the waterfront has not been followed, nor perhaps even understood. Another area in which Correa has done pioneering work is affordable housing. Here is a project in Belapur in Navi Mumbai that, instead of building apartment blocks, gives each family its own site to build an independent house.
Delhi.
Row housing, which is a conventional way to achieve higher densities, severely restricts light and air for the houses. But the same densities can be achieved with freestanding houses. Here are seven of them arranged around a small courtyard. By repeating this pattern again and then again, we get 24 houses, which through the same process reaches 82. In a pattern which generates community spaces integrated with the housing.
This affordable housing project accommodates 600 families in an area of just 6 hectares. This includes schools and other community spaces integrated seamlessly with the houses themselves. Another set of urban issues in which Correa was deeply involved concerned the mill lands in Bombay. The heart of the city was its textile mills. The mills closed down, one by one, over the last two decades after a protracted strike. This led to thousands losing their jobs. The recycling of the vast tracts of land in the center of the city has been one of the major issues facing Mumbai. This public exhibition, sponsored by the Urban Development Research Institute and organized by Correa, addressed the problem of recycling these mill lands. It advocated that a portion of the land should be used to provide schools, parks, and other social amenities for the city. It also emphasized the need for east-west public transport to connect the western shore of the city to the eastern waterfront, and thence across to Navi Mumbai and the rest of Maharashtra. Correa's family comes from Goa. He has many relations and friends here. Goa is a second home to him. He has designed his own house in Goa along the banks of the historic Mandovi River. You feel you're floating here, suspended above the river.
You know, it's wonderful living here on the edge of this historic river. The Mandovi is really the history of Goa. Just about every invader came in down this river through that pass and to old Goa. That is Adil Khan, then Albuquerque, the whole lot of them, and the battles that were fought along this river all the way down there. It gives you a great sense of the primordial, and yet so it's so calm right now.
When we were in Goa for the shoot of this film, Correa took us around to see some of Goa's indigenous architecture that had developed organically with time. Correa's own projects in Goa reflect this context, but they also address an issue which is of crucial importance to him, and that is the relationship of architecture to the other visual arts, painting, sculpture, and landscape. One of these projects is the Hotel Cidade de Goa.
In this hotel in Goa, Cidade de Goa, we knew that it had to have a certain level of nostalgia because it was a tourist hotel. But I felt we could do this by having a layer of virtual imagery which would come from painting. And so the building is built, and in the process of building it, you realize there are moments which the architecture has to be corrected. For instance, let's take the room we're in, this one. All the light is coming from this window. There's not much happening behind me. But if we had an artist to paint a street scene here, a street coming on another one there, and they meet at the corner, the tension from that corner would balance all the light coming in from the window. That is how actually you see, when you go to Florence and you see the murals, they're correcting the architecture and vice versa.
The Kala Academy is a cultural center for the arts, painting, music, cinema, theater, and so on. Situated on the banks of the Mandovi River, the building is really one large veranda with the sea breezes blowing right through. And here again, there is that interplay between architecture and virtual imagery. In the interior of the main auditorium, the virtual balconies are a collaboration between Correa and Mario Miranda, the celebrated Goan cartoonist. In the British Council building in Delhi, the gigantic mural by Howard Hodgkin is like the shadow of a banyan tree, a shadow in which a number of different mindsets continue to live together in India.
Whether these forms are the limbs of a tree or a catalpa or a banyan or whatever, you have a sense of an organic form. That's the key thing. And of course, this tension that exists between this organic form contained within a rather severe building, austere building in a certain sense, except it has this wonderful pink sandstone. It's a wonderful balance. And you have this sense of these forms sort of pushing their way out.
Down the center of the site are three axis mundi. That is the mythic axis that connects earth to sky. At the far end of the site is the axis mundi of Hinduism, the Bindu, the source of all energy. In the center is the Charbagh, the mythic Persian image of the Garden of Paradise that Islam brought to India. And at the entrance, we have the European axis mundi from the Renaissance, a symbol used by Michelangelo in the Capitol in Rome. So the building is really many layers, a palimpsest, like India herself.
We have our own agendas. You're asked to do something, and of course you solve the practical problem, hopefully, but you also should, and you do have, other intentions. So in this particular building, the client just wanted a library and some offices, but they were very supportive and said, look, why don't we try and express something more ambitious? And then, of course, Howard Hodgkin came in with this mural of India as a large tree which can protect all that, which shades all that, which lets all that pluralism happens because it is India.
This is the original artwork that Howard Hodgkin's made for the British Council mural. We are in the Correa home here in Bombay, where the family has lived for more than four decades. The tapestries on these walls are the work of his wife, Monica Correa, who is a textile weaver. In these pieces, she uses only hand-spun wool and unbleached cotton. Monica and Charles were married in 1961. They have two children, Nandita and Nakul. through the years, the children have grown up. And now they have 5 grandchildren. Monica's works hang in museums and galleries and in private collections, including the Four Seasons in New York, where Philip Johnson commissioned 4 tapestries. Monica's weaving has had considerable influence on Charles's own work, and they have often worked together, as on the interiors for the Hotel Siddharth in Goa and the Bay Island Resort in the Andamans.
Well, India has a wealth of textiles. I mean, we all use textiles in our everyday lives. Textiles even played a wonderful role in the freedom struggle. That's why you have a charkha actually on the national flag. As a young girl, I would look at these beautiful temple saris that came out of Kanchipuram. I was fascinated by the motifs that they had worked into these saris. One found that these patterns existed in India in all these spheres of weaving, of jewelry, of into sculpture and architecture. Well, here's an example of it. This is a sari from Orissa, and you have the mandala, and here are the 9 squares, and the fish, and the Rudraksh. These motifs were based on religious motifs or sacred motifs, or the symbols of fertility, which were used and incorporated in these textiles.
Charara charara maru chakadol chale. Charara charara maru chakadol chale.
A prime example of these connections was Vistar, the exhibition on Indian architecture that Charles and his colleagues organized for the Festival of India. It was an eye-opener for many of my generation. It made us take a fresh look at a number of familiar practices we just took for granted.
We started with the way people live, you know, it's not, and the patterns go very, very deep. It comes out of the way they live, the fabrics they wear, the rangoli patterns on the floor. These are all memories of something sacred. And it's incredible, it runs all the way through life. So the mandala is not just present in the museums like it is in some other society. In India, it comes right into what some street people are doing by making these things, these patterns. So in this exhibition, we first of all positioned architecture in its relationship to all these other things, including dance and sculpture. Mm. We made a list of all the buildings we would include, and I thought the old buildings would be beautiful, but the buildings, the contemporary ones, I mean, of that century, the 20th century, would be the ones with ideas of, you know, Corbusier and all that. And I was wrong. The old buildings were not only spectacularly beautiful, they had the ideas. They were based on the most profound ideas about the cosmos. In fact, architecture was seen as a model of the cosmos.
This is Modera with a beautiful kund in front of the temple. If the temple is a model of the cosmos, then this kund is an inverse model of the cosmos, inlaid into the earth. It's really so beautiful, for as the water recedes, the same rituals can be performed at different levels.
This is Jaipur, the city planned by Jai Singh, its 18th century ruler, to represent Navagraha, the mandala of the 9 planets. Because of a hill, one of the squares got moved to the other side.
And the wonderful thing about Jaipur is that Jai Singh, who was the ruler who built it, had these 2 takes on the sky. One was the oldest myths of the 9 planets, Navagraha. The other was the newest myths of science, which had just started in measuring, trying to measure the sun and the moon, but through instruments which were not movable, because that spoils the whole accuracy. These are huge values which science brought, and he'd combined them both in the city. And I thought that's wonderful, because he was really looking backward and forward in one gesture. Jai Singh was a truly extraordinary man. In a certain sense, perhaps he was the first modern Indian and a precursor of Nehru, who also, when we became an independent nation in 1947, tried to rediscover India's past while simultaneously opening a door to a brand new future.
So when Correa was asked to design this art center in Jaipur in memory of Jawaharlal Nehru, he designed a contemporary building that was based on the same Navagraha, connecting past and present in one integrated gesture in honor of Nehru and of Jai Singh. The brief prepared by the state government listed a number of items, like art galleries, exhibition halls, craft workshops, theatres, and so forth. Correa took these requirements and ingeniously assigned each one of them to the appropriate planet. One of the squares is moved, recalling the gesture of Jai Singh that created the plan of Jaipur. And we find again the pathway that moves through it all, sometimes open to sky and sometimes undercover.
So here you have the nine planets, and one of them is moved to the right, and that gives the public access to Mangal, which is for the administration, Guru, the library, and Shukra, where the theatres are. That movement gave me access to the mandala. So we enter here. This is where the administration is, Mangal, the planet of power. On this dome, Rajasthan's traditional artists have depicted a giant cosmograph representing the entire manifest world, every tree, every fish, every animal, every mountain. Similarly, each one of the other nine planets has its own unique plan and form, illustrating the traditional qualities of that planet, including its auspicious colors.
In the center is the ninth square, an open-to-sky amphitheater. This is crucial, for when you move around through the other squares, you sense your orientation through the glimpses you get of this empty center. On the red sandstone walls of each planet is inlaid its traditional symbol in white marble and black kadapa stone. While Correa was designing the Jawahar Kala Kendra in Jaipur, he wondered, could one design a modern building based on today's notions of the cosmos, the black holes of outer space, the Big Bang theory, the ever-expanding universe? The opportunity came when the renowned mathematician Jayant Narlikar and his team of scientists asked him to design the Inter-University Center for Astrophysics at Pune University.
Today's ideas of what actually is the reality of the non-manifest world, let's say, around us, is much more mind-blowing than anything out of the poor mandala. It's very down-to-earth compared to what scientists believe and which all of us accept. But we don't make part of our lives. One thing about the ancients, they made the mandala part of their lives, their jewelry, their everything. Professor Narlikar, the mathematician, he asked me if I would design a center for him at Pune University for astronomy and astrophysics. And I said, on condition we try to do this, express the ideas you believe in. And it was wonderful, because you need a very supportive client to do something like that. And he and the other scientists there, in fact, most of the ideas of, I don't know what the universe is about, they did. And most of the ideas came from them. So here landscape is used not just to look pretty,
but to represent certain truths from contemporary science. For instance, this courtyard had two trees. Instead of removing one of them, it was decided to keep them both to represent the Roche lobes, which are the energy fields generated by two adjacent planets in outer space. Another example is Sierpinski's gasket, a fractal pattern that stays identical regardless of any magnification or reduction.
In today's context, these two projects at Jaipur and Pune are very unusual in that they are both models of the cosmos. Each project, in its own way, seeks to invoke the metaphysical dimensions that lie in architecture, just below the surface.
I think the courtyard is the third manifestation, to my mind, of this paradigm. So the first was the mandala with the empty center, then finding an echo today in the black holes of outer space, and then really existing in all cultures throughout human history in the courtyard house. Wherever you go, there's always a house around a courtyard or a building, and it always works. It doesn't matter if it's made of mud or made of stainless steel. There's something about the centrality and the emptiness of that center which keeps you looking at it. And it's unfortunate that in the modern movement it hasn't been used very much, mainly because the modern movement came out of Northern Europe, Anglo-Saxon, that kind of world which likes the freestanding house, which is what you see in suburbia. Our own traditions of the Haveli, etc., are really of the empty center, the house around, looking at it, and the street outside.
Correa has used courtyards in many different ways, here in a high-tech center. In the MRF headquarters, the atrium, which is another version of the courtyard, expresses the powerful centrality of its prototype, connecting the various office levels easily and naturally. The Brain and Cognitive Center at MIT Boston is a cutting-edge scientific institution and the largest center for brain research in the world. The site was an exceptionally difficult one. It is really two separate sites on either side of an existing railroad track. It houses three separately funded institutes, but Correa took this easily in his stride and created a piece of sculpture that rides serenely above all these problems. Bhavan, the Legislative Assembly of the Government of Madhya Pradesh in Bhopal, is a prime example of Correa's use of courtyards and atria to bring light and air into the heart of a large building. The building, located on top of a hill in the middle of the city, is seen from miles around in all directions.
The thing about this building is that it's on top of a hill and you've got a road twisting and coming towards it. It's not a straight road. So the building turns as you approach it, and I found a rectangular building would change proportion. But the circular building always looks the same. And so we decided on a circle, and we had to fit all the various things into it. So
So these were arranged around these courtyards. So you've got 9 compartments. The center one and 4 of them are open. These are open to sky. This one in the corners is you have the combined hall, the lower house, the upper house, Vidhan Parishad, and then the library.
This is the entry courtyard for the public, with murals painted by an extraordinary painter from Bastar, the largest tribal region in India. There is also other site-specific art created by India's leading painters and sculptors. In Bhopal, a little further down the road from the Vidhan Bhavan, is Bharat Bhavan, also using courtyards but in a completely different architectural concept. It is what Correa calls a non-building. In fact, when I entered the gate of Bharat Bhavan, I couldn't see any building at all.
Yes, it's built into the hill. It's what I call a non-building, which I think is another way of seeing architecture. We made it like a public garden. In fact, people come there to use the terraces as a garden, and then they can go down through these series of courtyards where the different facilities are located. And it works because it is so casual that people, and average people, go to see it. They come on their scooters, a whole family, and then they really come for both, to walk in the garden, and then some of them get tempted, most of them do, because the concerts are free very often, or the theater, or they go in to see one of the art collections.
The descending courtyards culminate in an amphitheater on the edge of the lake. Maybe I should say they dissolve into a view of the lake. For Correa, the non-building is an essential step towards finding an architecture that is rooted in India.
Louis Kahn used to say, "I love English history. I have an 8-volume edition that I read all the time." And then he'd add, "Well, actually, I've only read the first volume." And even that, after the first few pages, I stop. Because I don't believe that history started the way they say it started. I think it started before that. I want to read volume 0.
Modern architecture. It started really with the Greeks. If you look at the Parthenon, it's on a hill, and it doesn't imitate nature. That is the way the European, the Mediterranean people felt, that man does not imitate nature, but he doesn't destroy nature. There's a dialogue between the Parthenon on the hill and then the nature around. And what is interesting is that paradigm came down through the Romans, it came to Palladio and to all the classical architecture. It came all the way to Corbusier. Corbusier never imitated nature. His buildings are very much a man-made object. Now, all of the architecture we build comes down that line. And then what? We turn left to reach India or turn right to reach Japan? We cannot. That's our problem. What is interesting to my mind is that if you look at Hinduism or Buddhism as being two of important factors in India, neither of them would build something in that simple dichotomy, man and nature. If I look at the caves in Ajanta, are they leaving the hill alone or are they destroying it? Neither. They have done some, there is an intervention, but it's a very ambiguous one. So if I start then with that idea that I don't dominate the hill, neither do I leave it alone, I come down a different pathway. And that pathway would bring me to, I think, what to be closer to a non-building. I feel that's really, really important. You have to start with a different paradigm.
Correa's newest project is in Lisbon. It is the Champalimaur Research Centre, a cutting-edge scientific facility located on an extraordinary site situated at the point where the river meets the Atlantic Ocean, and from where Vasco da Gama set sail for India and the unknown. The project brings together a number of the themes that have obsessed Correa: the ritualistic pathway, the metaphysics of open-to-sky spaces, the concept of the non-building.
It's a beautiful site they've been given. It's where Vasco da Gama and Henry the Navigator and all those went out from there with the maps they had. I think they got the maps from the Moors because they had no idea where they were going. They went right out into the sea, which was like outer space. It's like saying that here's a map to get to Mars, hopefully, and you get into the spaceship and you go out without having any guidance, no computers, nothing. Project belongs on the site. You could build the same thing in Bombay or in New York, but it wouldn't have the same wallop as it does here for the Portuguese. It reminds them of what was probably the defining moment of their history 500 years ago. In fact, one of the objectives of this research center is to bring back that sense of excellence, of daring, which was there in their nation and which is there latent right now.
Many years ago, Correa wrote, "Strange indeed, that man, since the beginning of time, has always used the most inert materials like stone and brick to express the invisibilia that move him."